a long hate relationship. Upset now because of the Chinese Communist Party's crackdown on Falun Gong, though Mark Litke told us on the phone the other day that the Chinese don't pay nearly as much attention to it as we do. Barbara Walters, who is with us today, must have some evocative memories because, Barbara, you went with President Nixon when he went to China.
I did indeed. It was 28 years ago, and Peter, it was like going to the moon. By the way, a year after Tiananmen, I interviewed Jiang Zemin. I asked him about the uprising at Tiananmen Square, and he said, "Much ado about nothing." He said it in English. But Peter, when I went with a small group of reporters to China, there was no color at all. You couldn't tell the men from the women. Everyone was in uniform. Mao Zedong was the premier. The Cultural Revolution was on, cracking down on artistic and intellectual life. It could not be more different in less than these 30 years. It was like going to the most foreign country you could possibly have visited.
I think many people believing that will be very surprised if communism lasts deep into the 21st century, because from Shanghai, where Mark Litke is tonight, to Beijing, as Barbara just points out, the technological revolution has reached the country with enormous proportions. Mark Litke, you and I were reminiscing the other day that if you couldn't be in Times Square, you could get exactly the same feeling in downtown Shanghai.
Absolutely. And this morning I actually went down to People's Park in central Shanghai, which was the site of the old race course, horse racing course during colonial times. And it was a brilliant day, people strolling with their families, taking in the good weather. And I have never, I talked to a great many people out there, I have never seen Chinese so optimistic. Always a little cautious. This is still a country where people take two steps forward, one step back. But beyond that caution, there was an optimism that China has turned a corner in recent years, that the future is brighter than anything they, their relatives, their ancestors have ever known.
Thank you, Mark Litke, our chief Asia correspondent, who knows China and most of the other nations in Asia so well, for reminding us that between these two superpowers, the United States and China, it was America who led the way in looking out to the rest of the world. China was far behind. But when you look at Pudong on the other side of the river there, and even what's happened to Shanghai, what's happened to Beijing, and the kind of change that is irresistible in China, even for a Communist Party very much still in charge of the political and police apparatus, the next century is going to be very, very different. We'll continue our Millennium coverage in just a moment.
This is ABC 2000, the celebration of the millennium, brought to you by 2000. From Around the World continues. Now from New York, Peter Jennings.
Good morning again, everybody. It's a little after 11 o'clock. We do this all day long, a little after 11 o'clock Eastern Time, whatever time it is where you are. We've already passed some of the really significant midnights around the world. We've started in the Pacific, in case you're just turning on your television, and we are working our way all the way across the world today. In terms of major news of the day, other than the millennium itself, the end of the century, the big news was earlier today made by Boris Yeltsin. The president of Russia has said he was going to resign, not serve out his term, and has appointed Vladimir Putin, who now, among other things, has control of Russia's nuclear arsenal. He became acting president this morning after Mr. Yeltsin surprised the nation by announcing his resignation. And a Russian news agency report says Mr. Putin has promised to uphold key freedoms and crush any attempt to destabilize the country. He's a real manifestation at the moment, is Mr. Putin, of the Russian determination to have strength prevail in the country and a better sense of order than they have. In Washington, not long ago, President Clinton, on his way from one place to the other, was asked what he thought about the changes. He'd already talked to Mr. Yeltsin.
In that spirit, I look forward to working with Acting President Putin as the Russian people begin the process of making the transition from one democratically elected president to another. To President Yeltsin, let me convey my appreciation again for the work we have done together. Hillary and I extend our warmest wishes to him, Naina, and their family. Thank you very much.
Mr. Clinton and Mr. Yeltsin got along. A lot of people thought that Mr. Clinton had invested too much in Mr. Yeltsin himself as a political leader, but now Russia has a new one, a strong man whose first order of business is to conduct successfully the war against the rebellion in Chechnya. Elsewhere in the world, there's a tremendous feeling of relief on the subcontinent today, Pakistan, India, and in Afghanistan, because that hostage crisis on the Indian Airlines plane is over. These are the hostages arriving in New Delhi today. They were freed as the result of a negotiation between the Indian government and the hostage takers, who held them for 6 days. One man was killed. You may recall at the very beginning there were mostly Indians on board, one American, one Canadian, Japanese, several Europeans. And in Afghanistan itself, the government, the Taliban government, has given the hijackers and the three prisoners they managed to get out of Indian jails 10 days, I beg your pardon, 10 hours to get out of the country or they will be arrested. The ruling Taliban, not very widely thought of in many parts of the world, have indeed helped to improve their external image by bringing this crisis to a halt. On the subject of potential crisis, we want to go now to Washington because ABC Sam Donaldson is at our Y2K government headquarters in Washington. Sam, what have you been seeing, if anything?
Well, Peter, we're spinning cobwebs here, and that's a good thing, because it means that there are no Y2K problems of any size that have been reported so far in the major countries that we've passed. New Zealand, Australia, nada. In the eastern portion of the Russian Federation, and particularly where the power plant, the Bilibino power plant was looked at, nothing. Bilibino was all right. Japan, very important, because next to the United States, it has more computers, more computer technology than any other nation. And it got a slow start in its fixes. But Peter, we've had no reports of any big problems in Japan, either in telecommunications, either in power, or of course the nuclear power plants. Brings us to China. You've just watched what's happening there. We have no reports yet. It's early, of course, about China. China is being very secretive. It's keeping its people in the dark about this. It's taking a lot of precautions. It's closed its ports. It's said there'll be no unnecessary surgeries. It's given a 4-day holiday to its people. And, of course, as someone pointed out earlier, Jimmy Walker, a lot of its software, up to 98%, has been pirated, so they don't get the Microsoft fix down the line real quick. But, Peter, it just really, for those who worried, and I think the worry was justified, and we can't look back and say, well, what were you doing worrying? For those who worried, so far, cobwebs.
Thank you very much, Sam, in Washington. I want to go very briefly now to the man who's watched this story more closely than anybody for us, Jimmy Walker. We actually asked him to go to New Zealand because it was going to be the, hey, James, the first industrial country to have some experience with Y2K. You're listening to Sam there. Any surprises in all of this to you?
Well, surprises only in that it is such a complicated problem and it has gone so far so smoothly. Here in New Zealand, we can only echo exactly what Sam is reporting elsewhere. 12 sectors have reported in so far, electricity, gas, oil, energy, no problems whatsoever, though the government is telling the people here that they should keep their attention to this problem, should continue to stay alert until March 31st.
And that's exactly the point I actually wanted you to make. Just because we don't have any Y2K problem today doesn't mean that Y2K or some millennium bug is not going to show up in the least expected place, correct?
That's absolutely right. I mean, just, you know, as we have talked throughout the evening, you've gotten fixed this code and there could still be other problem areas. February 29th is going to be a potential problem. The end of the first quarter, computer systems that perhaps were fixed, perhaps were not fixed, are going to be called on to do functions that they had not done before. We have to wait and see.
Jimmy, before you left to go to New Zealand, we were talking about a lot of the neonatal clinics in various corners of this country alone. And it is that smallest of component that can cause trouble, correct?
Yes, you're absolutely right. I mean, you just don't know where it can come from, or you certainly don't know when it is going to strike. You can test and test and test, but one thing that I have heard again and again is that in this technology, you cannot test to completion. You just have to keep doing it again, and you've got to be patient.
Thanks very much, Jimmy Walker, who's in Wellington in New Zealand. One last quick comment from Sam Donaldson in Washington for the moment. Sam.
Peter, I think you and Jim hit on something. Businesses don't open until Monday morning, so all the businesses that said, we're okay, we don't know about that. Down the line, the ripple effect can take months, as a matter of fact. Let me just give you one statistic here in the United States. A couple of surveys looked at the medical profession and the medical field and found out that as of a few months ago, they thought they'd have 77% of their billing apparatus up to snuff, but only 26% of their biotechnical apparatus. What does that say? I don't know, but we're going to find out in the days ahead.
Thanks very much, Sam. We'll be back to join Sam, Jimmy Walker, and everybody else on our Millennium coverage when we return.
ABC 2000 will continue live from around the world in one moment.
Three of the really interesting celebrations we've had as the new century arrived. First in Sydney, Australia. They had a ball in Sydney Harbour. Great enthusiasm across all of its five time zones there. This continent in the Pacific, which has increasingly, to the strains of auld lang syne, made itself more of an Asian nation and will increasingly do so in the 21st century. In Seoul, as they ring the great peace bell, we are reminded of how important this nation is to the United States. We talked earlier to the 20 commander of the U.S. forces there. Okay. We got him a little mixed up, and it was more my fault than anybody else's, and I apologize. We'll get back to highlights a little later on in the broadcast. Right now, we're going to go away so that you can get caught up with your local news, much of it millennium-oriented, all around the country.
Millennium. Good morning. I'm Antonio Mora from ABC News headquarters in New York. Peter Jennings will be back in a few minutes. First, there is major news today. President Clinton is praising Boris Yeltsin for building democratic institutions in Russia. Yeltsin unexpectedly resigned today and named Prime Minister Vladimir Putin as acting president. Also, the first of 155 people held hostage for a week on an Indian Airlines airplane have arrived in New Delhi. They were freed in Afghanistan today under a deal between the hijackers and the Indian government that set free three jailed Kashmiri militants. The millennium heading our way has now reached the Asian mainland. These pictures we're going to show you now are from China, when 25 minutes ago, the world's most populous country entered the 21st century. China just adopted the Western calendar 50 years ago, and the government is reportedly keeping a tight watch on festivities, offering only some limited official celebrations. The one we're looking at here was in the capital, in Beijing. And now we switch over to midnight, which arrived at the same time in the Philippines. Here are some of the celebrations there at one of the busiest sections of Manila. We are looking at Regina Velasquez, one of the country's top recording artists. She is singing to the crowd her own composition for this event called Written in the Sand. And in Taiwan, more music to greet the millennium and to forget a difficult year there. This past September, Taiwan's strongest earthquake in a century killed more than 2,000 people and damaged tens of thousands of buildings. Now we're going to switch over to Hong Kong, where minutes ago, action movie star Jackie Chan, with a few of his best friends, all of them stuntmen, took a little jump.
Wow,
the stage, Jackie Chan sang this Millennium theme song. All this is taking place at the Happy Valley Racetrack in Hong Kong. It's been a fixture in Hong Kong since 1846. Horse racing is called there the national sport often, and they bet enormous amounts of money there, $11.7 billion just in the 1978 to 1988 season. It's the third largest betting in horse racing after Japan and the United States. When we return, Peter Jennings and the future of medicine in the new millennium. And we will head to the United Kingdom, where for this millennium, the sun is setting for the final time on the seat of the British Empire.
Here is a marching group of suffragettes. Women need the vote, they said in the early part of the century. By the time the 20s came along and urban America became fast and fashionable, women had a good deal more freedom than they had had in rural America just before then, and here's what the flappers looked like in the highly energized urbanization of America in the 1920s. But how could we look ahead in the world without going back to Paris and talking about the fashion of the next century and Barbara Walters? Barbara.
Thank you, Peter. By the way, women didn't get the vote in France until 1944. But you know, France itself is female. It's La France. And I just want you to look, Peter, for a moment at the Eiffel Tower now, because Paris is its most glamorous. It's a clear night. You can see that it says 7 hours until midnight, when the Eiffel Tower is going to have 20,000 lights and 20,000 different flashes of firecrackers and fireworks that are going to go all the way up to the 1,000-foot top. It's an absolutely beautiful and very glamorous night, which is the way Paris should look. Okay, on to couture. You know, it is the style center, and for over 100 years, Paris has been leading the way in fashion and making a lot of money to boot, especially with perfume that comes from the couture houses. Haute couture, that is, made to order, the clothes still cost $20,000 to $50,000, something like that, and there are still 22 fashion houses of the greatest names. So what we thought we would do is to take four of them, we'll start with one now, and ask them what they would design for me or for the millennium. Okay, this is the way they expect us to look. It is rather fantastic, but take a look. This first one that you're about to see was designed by a relatively young Englishman who is actually working now for the renowned house of Christian Dior. And there it is. Here is his red vision for the future, heaven help me. The coat is mohair and leather, and the whole deal costs $28,535. It isn't exactly me. Here we go.
We're just here to help, as accomplices, to help women look divine.
John Galliano is the latest designer for Christian Dior, which opened its doors 50 years ago. He was chosen for his fresh and unusual approach to fashion. Since his student days in London, his eye for verve and style has been apparent. John Galliano, you look wonderful. But
thank
I look
you.
Wonderful.
Okay, you look pretty fierce too.
This is the way you're going to look in the 21st century?
Yeah, this is how I'm going to work. I'm wearing street clothes, jeans that I bleached myself.
This is how I'm going to look in the 21st century?
One of the ways you could look, yes. One of the ways is beautiful mohair coat, very light. That's what's magical about this coat. It's the lightness. You have the volume, but it's so light. And that shiny croc finish, which is so sexy. Then you have the beautiful leather skirt there, studded and zipped, and with the boots.
And with the boots.
Killer boots.
How are we going to be dressed 50 years from now?
Well, there's a more relaxed mood. One should be able to mix both haute couture with pieces from ready to wear and feel very relaxed in it, but it just seems right.
Now tell me, is this the way I should look in the air? What do you think?
Beautiful.
Just the way you want me to look?
Beautiful. You're drinking the light and the light is loving you.
And you look just the way I want you to look.
Thank you.
Thank you. And here is the way he wants me to look. But Peter, I don't think it really is the real me.
Well,
it is couture, though.
I must confess, I'm glad you said it. I didn't think the red one was really you, but you look very lovely in green. And let it never be said, Barbara, you don't have tremendous courage. No, thanks very much.
Foolhardy, by the way, thank you. This is Yves Saint Laurent. This is just a little green suede jacket that I borrowed. And this is probably worth about $15,000 or $18,000. It's about time I came home.
Yes, and then I can remind people that it was in 1901 that the washing machine was invented. Women, take note. We'll be back in a minute. City, to be much more precise. And one of the reasons we asked ABC's Cokie Roberts to go to the Vatican was because she has friends in high places. Cokie?
Well, I have relatives in high places, Peter. My mother, Lindy Boggs, is with me here, I'm happy to say. Mama is, for those of you who don't know, the United States Ambassador to the Holy See. And Mama, the first thing everybody asks me is, how is the Pope?
The Pope is wonderful. And I think that it's so very, very special to have him giving a message to the world tonight. The bells in the background are telling us it's almost time for Vespers. And when he comes on into the audience there within St. Peter's and gives a message of hope and love and excitement for the youth and the use of science in the new century, how great it's going to be.
Mom, this spot where we're sitting has seen several millennia now come in, and I'm not saying you have, but but you've seen a lot of this century without giving away your age.
Uh-huh.
And the passage of time is part of what the Pope will be talking about, but do you want to reflect for just a second about the passage of this century?
Well, the passage of this century to me is something that's very special, mostly because I have so many grandchildren and great-grandchildren, and I've been associated with, of course, the government of the United States, either from my family or myself, for so many years. And now to have you and other members of the family who are able to express what our country is all about, what world peace is all about, and what this celebration is all about is just absolutely marvelous.
And the Pope will be talking about how human beings are the only creatures who know about the passage of time. We only have a few seconds, but what do you think about that?
I think that he knows so much about the passage of time, and I think he's so hopeful for the future and is such an inspiration to young people.
Thank you, Mommy. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, beautiful.
Back to you, Peter, in New York.
Thank you very much, Cokie. Very touching. I can't remember when anybody cut their mother off like that before. Very great politeness, or call the subject Mommy. We'll be back in just a moment.
Stay with us for the global event of the century. Still ahead, Queen Elizabeth lights a beacon on the Thames. There's change in Russia as midnight arrives. President Clinton talks to the world's children. Plus the latest on Y2K. ABC 2000, 24 incredible hours continue.
Rangi is the location for a big spiritual welcome of the Light 2000 to New Zealand. It's the first place on mainland New Zealand to see the light. And we're going to see a very traditional ceremony of the unveiling of a sculpture on the mountain of Maui facing towards Hawaiki, which is the place where Polynesian migration originated. The gathered Maori will perform what is called a haka.
Bye.
again, we are in northern New Zealand watching a ceremony celebrating the first light of the new millennium. It's on Mount Hikurangi. And it's being performed by the native Maori. It's another one of the many sites from around the world that we're bringing you as part of the ABC 2000 coverage. Coming up next, we will go back to Peter Jennings, and he will check in again with Cokie Roberts, who got the Plum Assignment of the Year, welcoming the new year in Rome. Also, we are going to Indonesia to see how they will greet the millennium there. We'll be right back.
The first light has come to New Zealand. The first light of 2000. New Zealand's having a great day in terms of the rest of the world. During the eve of the new millennium, more than 1,000 members of Ngatipuru, an ancient northern island tribe of New Zealand, have gathered together to come for this celebration. Indigenous people of New Zealand, Maoris, New Zealand being the largest of all the Polynesian islands. This is more modern New Zealand, though the Maori, in all fairness, play a big role in their country and a better role today than maybe in the last 50 years. Kiri Tikanawa. Thank you. From the easternmost point of the North Island, Gisborne in New Zealand, New Zealand's perhaps most famous entertainer, Dame Kiri Tikanawa, or Tikanawa, as some people say, preceded by the Maoris, the indigenous people, or a large measure of the indigenous people of New Zealand, who today only make up about 9 or 10% of the population, but who have struggled on into modern history. Midnight in Indonesia is coming up, on the island of Java, at the largest Buddhist temple in the world, in central Java. Celebrating now in the world's fourth most populous nation after China and India and the United States. And you see these Javanese dancers now acting out the law of karma, in which unworthy deeds are recognized by punishment and praiseworthy deeds, rewards of reincarnation. That was what we call a technical problem. Let's have a quick look at our control room for a second to show you the enormous challenge they have bringing in all of this from around the world. And that was a freeze frame in the middle of some satellite somewhere. But the reason Indonesia, of course, is so important is because not only is it the fourth most populous nation in the world, but because it's a nation where the United States has had a long, deep involvement and which has had a very recent troubled history. It's a fractious nation in which the new president, who will participate in this ceremony tonight, may be giving people more freedom than the military there actually want. We return to Java. It's in great contrast to this serenity, but when you ask political analysts in almost any Western government today what the hotspots are of the 21st century, they point to Indonesia. The recent difficulties, the recent trouble, the recent terrible problems in East Timor, where Australia took the lead in helping to rescue the East Timorese from the onslaught of the people in the mainland of Indonesia or in the capital of Indonesia, are merely a reminder to us of how much of a challenge Indonesia, with its enormous population and its 13,000 islands, is for the 21st century. Mark Lickey, our chief Asia correspondent. Mark, as we watch this, tell us what worries people in Asia about Indonesia now.
You know, so much, Peter, of this century we have had to live with the legacies of colonialism going back a number of centuries. Indonesia is a prime example of that, divided up by the Dutch and the Portuguese, lines drawn through and around and across tribal and ethnic groups, and kept that way by enforced colonialism for many years. And then when the country finally achieved its freedom after World War II, it took military dictatorships essentially to hold it together for the next four decades. Then in a very dramatic sudden turn of events, it is suddenly a democratic country. And all
the repressed anger and fears and discontent and economic inequities and everything else that was suppressed by colonialists and autocratic regimes over the years has just exploded onto the surface. Right now, as we speak, there are just bloody battles going on in the province called Molucca, which history remembers as the Spice Islands. And it is like going back 100 or 200 years. There are tribes of Muslims and Christians running around with bows and arrows and spears, murdering each other by the hundreds. And now, only in the last 24 hours, the Indonesian army has been sent in, a modern, well-equipped army, to try to suppress this. But suppression is all they can do, trying to get the people to live together who suddenly have
decided. Thank you, Mark. ABC special coverage of the Millennium continues, but we're going to pause for just a second here to let some affiliates leave us for a local news update, so we hope you'll stay with us.
That symbolizes, or that, where Hong Kong's national sport of horse racing takes place. Well, that is it for this half hour. When we come back, we will have more of ABC 2000 with Peter Jennings. He will return with Cynthia McFadden in Cuba and John Quinones in Miami. We will, of course, have much, much more. We still have hours and hours of celebration here as part of ABC's 2000 coverage. We'll be back.
Celebration of the millennium. This is ABC 2000. With Peter Jennings at ABC 2000 headquarters in Times Square, Barbara Walters in Paris, Diane Sawyer in New York, Charles Gibson in London, Cokie Roberts in Rome, Elizabeth Vargas in Sydney, Connie Chung in Las Vegas, Deborah Roberts in Orlando, Jack Ford in Times Square, Carol Simpson in Chicago, and Sam Donaldson at the Y2K Command Center in Washington. With our correspondents spanning the globe in Shanghai, Bombay, Bethlehem, Moscow, Havana, Rio de Janeiro, and across the U.S., reports from Miami, New Orleans, Tucson, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and in New York, Dick Clark counting down to the new year in Times Square. Special Millennium performances by Billy Joel, Elton John, Enrique Iglesias, Faith Hill, NSYNC, Fish, The Bee Gees, Aerosmith, Blondie, Bonnie Raitt, Neil Diamond, Harry Connick Jr., Kenny G, Ray Charles, The Eagles, Barry Manilow, David Blaine, and Barbra Streisand. Now, from ABC 2000 headquarters at Times Square in New York, Peter Jennings.
And around the world, and talk about the memorable images of the end of the century. Tower Bridge in London, overlooking the Thames, what a magnificent view. Big Ben, it is 5:30 in the afternoon or early evening in London, 6.5 hours before it is midnight there, and that astonishing great bell strikes for the last time this century. And in Paris, they have gone all out to make the Eiffel Tower, from the beginning of this century, of course, look as magnificent as it ever has at the end of the century. And in Rome, at St. Peter's Basilica, just to bring you up to date with the news, in Vatican City at this hour, Pope John Paul II is providing evening vespers for the large crowd there, which has gathered and increasingly continues to gather in Vatican City for the celebration of the millennium there. It shall be only a few more hours than London and Paris. This Pope, who has made such an impact on the world at the end of the century, some people think should actually be the man of the century for contributing, as he did, to the downfall of communism, first from his pulpit in Poland, but then much more dramatically from Vatican City itself. Elsewhere in the world at this hour, they have had a ceremony of ownership, I guess we can call it, of the Panama Canal by Panama. Just a short while ago in Panama itself, what the Panamanians are calling a reversion ceremony. You recall that President Carter signed a treaty in 1974 to turn over the canal to Panama on this date, December the 1st, 1999. Neither President Clinton nor the Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, decided to go, wishing in both cases, we believe, to put some distance between themselves and an issue which upset some Americans. But in Panama today, the canal is now theirs, and all Americans have now left operation of the canal zone. Elsewhere overseas, Vladimir Putin now has absolute control of Russia and the Russian nuclear arsenal. A surprise announcement this morning from Boris Yeltsin that he was going to give up the presidency and turn it over to to Vladimir Putin. President Clinton has had a chat with both of them today, and the president paid tribute both to Mr. Yeltsin and said he looks forward to working with Mr. Putin. Now, as we have gone around the world today, in case you haven't been with us, we have seen some quite extraordinary celebrations of the millennium. And yes, for those of you who argue that it's coming in a year from now, well, we can all do it again a year from now. But today, all the way across the Pacific and other parts of Asia, it has been quite a day of celebration. Here's ABC's Bob Brown.
The world is meeting the millennium with spectacular bursts of pageantry. Stilt performers called Mimi, Aboriginal people from Australia whose culture is 50,000 years old. Dancers enacting age-old customs in Jordan and Israel and the Philippines. South Korea's national music troupe performing in Seoul. This unprecedented global stage of events began when a torch was passed at the world's first midnight, where the millennium arrived in the South Pacific at a place that had been renamed Millennium Island, the easternmost island of Kiribati.
My dear child, take this torch of peace and hope from Kiribati so that it may light the whole world.
In a nation that saw heavy battle casualties during World War II when U.S. forces drove out the occupying Japanese army, the gifts of fire were taken to the sea by an old man and a boy while dancers chanted a farewell to the pain of the past in a traditional ceremony of good luck. Millennium computer bugs were of no concern on islands that would have been uninhabited had it not been for the celebration. But when the fireworks began in the first major city to see the 21st century, Auckland, New Zealand, the world was anticipating as well as watching. And in the first major Y2K test, the lights stayed on in Auckland. And as ABC News correspondent James Walker discovered, the ATMs were dispensing money.
This is an ATM receipt for, let me think, it's dated 1100, and the time on it is 3 seconds into the new year.
Midnight has now come and gone in Australia and in Japan and Korea. China celebrated its new millennium by asking its airlines to stay airborne to earn public confidence despite fears of Y2K bugs. This was also one of the countries that gave the world the technology it's using for most of the celebrations, fireworks. But one of the most gorgeous sights of all was this one from Taiwan, with thousands of wish lanterns released into a graceful breeze. In Antarctica, scientists have reset the location of the South Pole. This is where, by walking around the pole, you could pass through each of the world's time zones in a few seconds.
Yeah, that was
and in case you're wondering
millennium.
What's there to
okay,
do at the South
the
Pole.
Done. Let's party!
They had some fireworks, too.
Thanks very much, Bob Brown. Diane Sir has stayed here much longer than, well, not longer than you usually do, because you work a long day, I know, but and you've been out there. I love that Antarctic stuff. The fact that we can have a live camera in Antarctica, this extraordinary, pristine continent, is really fantastic.
Well, the whole pageant of the morning is so moving. I've been calling people around, and a number of people have called and left messages at my home to say that they've been welled up with tears, just at the diversity of the planet, if nothing else.
I think
it.
People are a little bit surprised. I must, to be perfectly honest with you and the audience, this international consortium of television broadcasters we put together, we weren't so sure of all the time.
Oh,
and
yes?
They probably weren't so sure of us either. But it's been quite a struggle to get all of the technical goings on together. And the website was crashing all the time just when we wanted information. But I must say, I'm surprised and thrilled by the beauty of how much we've seen today so far.
Yeah, I think people take the technology for granted right now, but if you could stand back in the control room and listen to these various parts of the world being queued up and watch them just
this
pop
is wonderful.
On
you,
the
you can
screen.
Call for the control room right now.
Yes, I've seen you do that.
Love it.
I can call.
Yeah, there it is.
I can make them wave. we can do anything we want. Hello, Roger. Well, you know, as we've been floating through all of these cultures around the world, one of the things we wanted to do, of course, this day was also do a little detective work on our own American culture. Wondering a bit on this eve of the new century, if in the next 100 years men will still be from Mars and women from Venus, for instance. Right. What about American families? And so we thought, how do we learn something about what this next century will be sociologically in America? So we gathered some experts together. They are ages 6 to 10. They are from different kinds of families, single-parent families, two-parent families. And we sat the girls in one place and interviewed them, and then the boys in another, to ask some questions and see what we could learn.
Ask children what they love most in the year 2000, and it's perfectly clear girls still tend to be girls, shouting out parties and makeup.
You can do makeup.
While boys tend to be, well, action video obsessed.
Pokemon cards, Game Boys, and video games.
And Henry?
Donkey Kong Country, Rayman 2, and probably Pokemon Red version.
And when it comes to courtship, it's still just miniature Mars and Venus. Girls talk feelings.
How do you know when you're in love?
Like when you're next to them, you get shy and you don't look at them or something.
And your cheeks are all red.
You kind of dream about them, like, sometimes.
Have you been in love?
No.
Well, for the boys, it's strategy. Trying to scope out what you think girls want.
What do you all think girls like the most? And makes them fall in love with a guy?
By them kissing you.
Be nice, truthful, honest, and give him flowers.
Flowers?
I've seen it on TV, I don't know.
You say good compliments about them, and if they like the compliments.
But as the children talked, we also began to hear something new. A certainty in both groups that girls are not only as smart as boys, but can do anything.
If you're a girl, can you be anything you want to be?
Yes.
Well, a long time ago, you couldn't.
That's true.
Can you be the president of a big company?
Yeah.
Can you be the president of the United States?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No?
No.
Why not? You don't think you can be?
Boys get elected to be president, but a girl has never got that far to be a president.
Just because there hasn't been doesn't mean there can't.
I thought there was.
Like, in the past, girls couldn't run for president, but only boys could.
And that's, you think that's different now, do you think?
Yeah. Much different.
Much different.
And not only that, both sexes told us that girls may even have an advantage because boys, well, are just not that honest.
But what about, say, cheat?
You think boys cheat more than girls?
Yeah.
And boys lie more, like Clinton. Clinton lied! Strike!
Do you think girls tell the truth more than boys?
Yeah, sometimes.
At my school, the boys tend to get in more trouble than the girls.
Why is that, you think?
I think boys are more wild.
I know, because you have to play. That's the best part.
But perhaps the thing that moved us the most about these 21st century kids facing a world in which half of marriages end in divorce was how passionate they are that two parents matter. Mom alone is not enough.
How important is it to have a mom and a dad in the house? Is it really important, or is it just sort of important?
Really important. Really important.
Extremely important.
Why do you say it's extremely important?
If you only had one, you don't get all the care you could get from both.
What's the best thing a mom can do?
Probably cook.
I think the best thing a mom can do is have you.
Who makes you feel happiest, just generally, when you're in the house?
Mostly my dad. Sometimes
Mostly my dad, because he usually goes to Burger King more and he buys me more toys.
My dad really spends time with me.
Most dads just, they have something in them that your mother doesn't have. And if it feels like they might have an empty space in your heart or something, if you don't have a dad, because they fill in something.
What does it take to make a really happy family?
It just takes trust and love and listening to each other to really have a really good family.
Yeah. Oh, to love your family.
Oh, that's not it.
What is it, Grandma?
Love, care, and friendship.
And to have a lawyer.
And to have a lawyer? So there you have the nuclear family of 1999.
Well, it's a little scary. It's a little frightening. You realize how many troubles there are. I saw a survey some time ago where it said we got to start treating boys in the new part of this century like we used to treat girls because boys have lost their self-esteem.
Well, I think a lot of people think there does need to be concentration on dads and boys, too. In fact, listening to these kids, I kept thinking, in the next century, people are going to say, that's as American as dad and apple pie, because dad is so central to their yearning and to their lives. And I was surprised, since, as we know, divorce is a matter-of-fact issue in this country, that they still feel as passionately as they do about their mom, their dad.
Yeah, I think divorce in this country is a matter-of-fact issue to everybody except their own divorce.
That's right, and their kids. Issue.
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
Okay, thanks, Diane. Mm-hmm. See you later. We'll be back in a moment as we continue our coverage of the millennium around the world. There is Paris getting ready. One city trying to outdo the other.
This is ABC 2000, the celebration of the millennium. Brought to you by AccuView Contact Lenses.
Well, here's some indication of what we have ahead of us. St. Paul's Cathedral in London stood throughout the Second World War. Everybody was convinced the Germans were absolutely determined to get that wonderful Wren church, and they did not. And look at how Paris is showing off tonight. This is as seen from the Eiffel Tower itself. Celebration in Paris, under 5 hours away. That's called the Trocadero on the east side. And right down in the foreground there, you can see the River Seine. And in Rome, the Pope has gone to the papal apartments to have a little bit of rest before he preaches again to the millenniums. He conducted Vespers just a short while ago in St. Peter's Basilica. And in Bethlehem, where we will celebrate the millennium as well, the crowd has not been deterred at all by all this talk of terrorism in the Middle East and elsewhere. This is the square just to the north. I guess you could call it Manger Square, just to the north of the Church of the Nativity, and ABC's Bill Blakemore is there. Bill.
Bit of a political rally going on here right now. That's Fatah, formerly the military arm of the PLO, which is now a legal political party in the Palestinian entity. But we've also learned tonight that the Palestinian police are looking for, among other people, Monty Kim Miller. They've been using pictures of him with their guards at the doors to try to find him. He is a Colorado-based self-appointed doomsday prophet who the Israeli authorities and American authorities have also been concerned about. Some members of his group have been deported. There's concern that he was going to get something organized for this evening, trying possibly, as the belief of such groups as his are, to try to begin the process which they say brings about the end of the world or the second coming of Christ. So we know that the authorities are still looking for them. They don't know where Monty Kim Miller is. They haven't been able to find him to arrest him over the past year, while they have found other members of his group. And we do know that the Temple Mount, the Dome of the Rock in the middle of Jerusalem, is one of the places that they're very concerned about as well, because they believe that if something happened there, it could mean the beginning of the end of the world, according to their beliefs.
Actually, I don't think we have a camera outside the Temple Mount at the morning, but Diane and I have been sitting here about sort of events that have moved the world. There are Christians out there who are more fundamentalist, of course, than about Judaism than Jews themselves now, and some of whom would like to see the Temple Mount, which is a Muslim mosque now built on top of this, which of course was the Second Temple, the Jews' Second Temple. They'd like to see it blown up, and it would cause havoc in the Middle East, I suspect, and throughout the Muslim world now.
Well, as you've been saying, and as Bill was saying, that everyone shows up there to affirm their right to be there and their passion about the place, even in the face of all these threats, says something too about the determination of others to make sure it doesn't happen.
You and I were talking about the Panama Canal, and it's 1908 when America gets involved. The French can do it, so the United States goes to make this extraordinary technological adventure of its day. And it gets handed back almost, or handed to the Panamanians almost with a whimper.
I know. My mother, in fact, I was just telling you in the break that my mother's been calling me a lot about it, because I think for Americans who remember how hard-won it was, not just to get it going technologically, but also with malaria and with everything that was paid in order to make sure that we had the Panama Canal, suddenly to give it back is a wrenching thing. Of course, they've argued that now it's not vital to our national security in the same way it once was, but I confess to a little bit of miserliness on my part.
Well, I mean, it's a great moment in what many people call the American century. When the first American engineer went to the Panama Canal, he took two coffins with him, once for himself and one for his wife, because they didn't have any defense against malaria there. And one of the contributions to science in this generation is having discovered what the mosquito could potentially do and cure it then.
I wanted to say, Peter, but as we're watching Bethlehem Square and the others, I've been noticing that now, back out in Times Square, the crowd has been creeping back as far as I can see, and as far as I know, the crowd at Times Square here in New York. Look at it now. There are about three people there over the age of 18 because it's freezing out there.
Well, it reflects the world, and it certainly reflects the Middle East, where we have been talking about, where more than 50% of the population is under 17. We'll be back to continue our Millennium coverage after this.
More Americans expect a cure for cancer than for the common cold.
Live from around the world, once again from Times Square, Peter Jennings.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good morning, wherever you are. It's just a little before 1 o'clock Eastern Time. We've been looking out at Times Square all morning. It's provided us with a tremendous amount of energy. And we've been joined very briefly by a dear friend and colleague of ours. They always say that on television. Todd Brewster, who's the editorial director of The Century, with whom we did the television series and the book this year. And we've been talking about what Times Square was really like. This has always been the sort of village green for New York.
That's the perfect way to phrase it. I mean, it really is a place where people come together at these incredible moments. The most famous one, of course, being VJ Day, when we had the famous picture of the kissing sailor, and everybody claims they were the sailor, they were the woman being kissed, and that sort of says something, I think, about the democratic nature of the whole gathering here over the time. It's a place where people come to sort of experience popular culture, too. This is where popular culture this century was born. When you think of all the great musicals of the 20th century, they started
We're surrounded by Broadway, of course. It looks so unbelievably different. We have several pictures, or a couple of pictures anyway, of Times Square. By the way, before you go any farther, Roger Goodman, just stop for one sec there, if you would, possible, because you're pointing right at now what used to be the Times building, right, Todd? The Times moved here. Everybody thought they were crazy going uptown, and behind all those advertising is this great, beautiful New York Times building.
And that's the other big thing about Times Square, is the advertising and the tawdry nature of everything here. And there are a lot of architecture critics who believe that that's something to preserve. They've actually worked hard to try to preserve the tawdry nature of Times Square, because it's part of its charm, part of what makes people come here.
As you look back over the century, and you look, there's a New York Times actually published a wonderful book called The Century in Times Square, which you and I are both looking at. As you look back over the century, through pictures and whatnot, is there any great, other than Victory Over Japan Day or VE Day, which you remember particularly?
Well, this is an incredible picture here, looking at men in fedoras, for one thing, but also looking at people who are in need of work during the Depression. There's another picture, I don't know if we have it, of the gathering to watch the World Series,
1919.
And the interesting thing, of course, about that picture, the 1919 World Series was the one that was thrown by the White Sox.
Black
Sox scandal
came
out of this.
But look at, you're right, look at the hats on these people who had gathered here. And what they were all sitting, see if we can orient people just a little. They were sitting to watch what's called the zipper, which was the news going round and round as it now.
Now there are several zippers, actually, in Times Square. It's actually become quite a place for watching the news in many ways.
Well, of course, this is just politically incorrect now, but that was the one I remember seeing for the first time when I came here in the late 1950s.
It's an ad which shows a man puffing smoke, actually, coming out of the Campbell cigarette ad. It was one of the things people most identified with Times Square, were these ads that actually came to life. And it's still true today. You look around here, you see these incredible advertisements for Coca-Cola, for whiskey, for Samsung, everywhere.
I'm going to cut you off for a second and go to the other great institution in New York City, the New York Stock Exchange. We're about to hear the sounding of the last bell of the 20th century. terribly good as far as I'm concerned. Are we hearing Auld Lang Syne played on the New York floor of the New York Stock Exchange? Didn't think they were that sentimental. Betsy Stark, are you still there on the floor of the exchange for us, I hope?
Yes, I am, Peter.
Do you know who's participating?
It's all that noise you hear are 2,000 balloons being popped to mark the end of the last day of trading of the millennium when the Dow and the NASDAQ hit another record in another record-breaking year.
Give us the figures, will you, if you know them off the top of your head?
Well, we won't have the final numbers for a few minutes, but the Dow Jones Industrials closed up 49 points, it looks like. Over 11,500, I think. And the NASDAQ, believe, is up 32, Peter. So just another incredible finish. Some of the global markets finished on record highs yesterday as well. Paris, London, Frankfurt, all closed out the years on a very high note.
Okay, we're a little misleading with that number on. That was actually the market for the year. And I don't want to make you shout any more than you have to. But, you know, you said some when the bell was rung to open the market today by Muhammad Ali, you were talking a little bit about what this marketplace would be like in the next century. For those who weren't here, can you review a touch of it?
The move is really toward, the trend is toward a market that may be more fully electronic. Some people think there may not be a floor-based trading that you see here at the New York Stock Exchange. Already we have markets in the world where it's all done by computer, an anytime, anywhere kind of model for trading stocks 24/7. That's what we could be headed for.
Thanks very much, Betsy. And I do something with your voice. I want to go back now down to Times Square on the subject of electronic trading and everything. Juju Chang is down there in the square with someone who is described as the e-commerce man of the year. Bears explanation, Juju.
Well, we're standing here with Brian Curry, and he is CEO of EarthCam. EarthCam is conducting a 24-hour website and web broadcast of the Times Square festivities, and Brian is joining us. Brian, where do you see e-business going in the next millennium?
Well, actually, webcam is going to be a big part of e-business going forward. Live visual information on the internet is a key area, and that's where our company EarthCam has been forging big areas in. Not only will you have images on computers, you'll have them on your cell phones, handheld devices. We see it as a key area.
Why is it such a booming part of the NASDAQ and the larger economy? E-business is so hot.
It is. It really is amazing. Because people realize it's a whole new medium that's out there, a whole new world. And they realize that even someone at home sitting at that computer now can direct their attention worldwide and they can expand and reach out around the world. It's an amazing opportunity that's happening right now.
You have 5,000 cameras stationed around the globe and you have 10 here in Times Square. Why do people come to EarthCam and to sites like yours?
Well, you know, I think visual information and getting a chance to explore the planet is very, very compelling. People love to be able to go, wow, they can go instantly live to Times Square. That's very cool if you're living in Sri Lanka or someplace like that.
Great, thank you very much. The webcast is being hosted and will continue for 24 hours. Peter, back to you.
Thanks very much, Juju. A good reminder there of how we are all linked together in so many different ways at the end of the century. When we come back, speaking of the subject of a wide world, we're going to talk to ABC's Jim McKay, who's taken us so many places in the latter part of this century to cover the world's great sports.
From around the world, ABC 2000. We'll continue in a moment.
This is the workshop.
Tearing their hair out at the Eiffel Tower. Since April of 1997, 1,000 days ago, they've been counting down the days, then the hours and the minutes it's supposed to come. But if you look at the Eiffel Tower now, there is a glitch. It says one and a T. It isn't moving. The hours aren't being counted down. And we don't know whether it's synchronized later with the 20,000 bulbs that are supposed to shine and the fireworks, but right now there is a glitch in the Eiffel Tower and they are frantic.
We can imagine. I hope you're keeping us on it, Barbara. In the meantime, let's go to Leipzig in Germany. At the famous Gewandhaus with the famous Gewandhaus Orchestra in Leipzig, which used to be East Germany and now is Germany again. They are playing Beethoven's and singing Beethoven's and acting Beethoven's Ode to Joy. Things we're trying to do is catch everything on tape, and Roger Goodman, our director in the control room, if you'll get me the famous Ode to Joy chorus, perhaps we can listen to it after we have talked to a man for whom the theme Ode to Joy was always emblematic of at least one point in the Olympics. Jim McKay, who has seen as much of the world as anybody and is a very close friend of a lot of ours, is here with us from our Washington bureau today. Well, Jim, as you look back on the century, you must have just one pocketful or pockets full of memories.
Well, I do, and at this moment I can't stop thinking about the very different mood the last time that you and I worked on a marathon telecast in Munich in 1972.
That's right, very much indeed. Do you want to take us through some of the great athletes you've been associated with in all of your career?
We could do something like that, the history of sports in about 5 minutes.
Good, and then we'll talk.
Why don't you roll it?
The first minority sports hero was Jim Thorpe. The Native American was a football star at Carlisle Indian School, a decathlon gold medalist in the 1912 Olympics, and a big league ball player. He's still considered the greatest all-around athlete ever. At a time when the mere thought of having a black man in the same ring as a white man made most whites uncomfortable, Jack Johnson became the heavyweight boxing champion, but he committed the then unforgivable sin of marrying a white woman and of flaunting his newfound wealth. Baseball, the only true professional team sport, suffered a near fatal blow when members of the Chicago White Sox threw the World Series in 1919. A stern judge named Kennesaw Mountain Landis was hired as commissioner. He restored the game's integrity, and a barrel-chested, spindly-legged kid out of a Baltimore boy's home became baseball's greatest star. George Herman Ruth became the beloved Babe, who hit home runs in numbers never dreamed of before. In the process, he blazed the trail for the professional athlete as a national icon. He was the biggest star of a decade known as the Golden Age of sports. But most of the heroes of the Golden Age were amateurs. A gentle lawyer from Atlanta, known to his fans as Bobby Jones, achieved the Grand Slam of golf and received a ticker tape parade in New York. Big Bill Tilden stood astride the world of tennis. Football's biggest stars came from the college ranks, not the pros. There was Illinois' galloping ghost, Red Grange, and the fabled four horsemen of Notre Dame, Stuldreher, Layden, Miller, and Sleepy Jim Crowley. For the first time, women attained national adulation. Helen Wills Moody, Little Miss Pokerface, they called her, won 19 major singles tennis championships, and a New York secretary named Gertrude Ederle swam the English Channel. The 1930s saw the rise of a gracious young black man from Detroit to the heavyweight championship. Joe Louis's fights with the German Max Schmeling were the stuff of legends. He served his country during World War II and was loved as no other African-American athlete before him. Babe Didrikson became known as the First Lady of sports. And in the 1936 Olympics, Jesse Owens won four gold medals and in the process shamed Adolf Hitler in his homeland. Baseball remained a lily-white enclave until a parsimonious, Bible-quoting general manager named Branch Rickey broke the barrier by the simple but shattering act of signing Jackie Robinson to a big league contract. Robinson took vicious abuse on the field and off from his opponents and even from some of his teammates, but he won the day with grace and tremendous talent. His arrival on the scene set the stage for the entire civil rights revolution that was to come. Still, black basketball stars could only find fame with the comic relief of the Harlem Globetrotters. It's difficult to recall that pro basketball was once all white, but it was until Chuck Cooper was signed by the Boston Celtics in 1950. The 1950s also marked the arrival of television as a powerful influence on the sports scene. At first, the new medium focused on questionable exhibitions like roller derby, featuring a fierce young woman called Tuffy Brazoon, and pro wrestling, as farcical then as it is today. The costumes and characters of the 90s were foreshadowed by a platinum blonde grappler called Gorgeous George. But more serious sport was to come. Pro football exploded into the national spotlight with the first overtime game between the Colts and the Giants in 1959. It's still called by many the greatest game ever played and set the stage for the NFL of today.
I'm the resurrected, the savior of the whole game. Every day I'm in the newspapers. You get tired of reading about me. All magazines, everything. I'm a big man.
Muhammad Ali came to the boxing scene as a teenage light heavyweight Olympic gold medalist in 1960 and dominated his sport for years. At first, he was a loudmouth, poetry-writing upstart, then a great heavyweight champion. His refusal to serve in Vietnam cost him his crown for 4 years, but he returned again and again, and in the end, he's a sentimental, revered figure. Through the years, all sports grew through television. The Olympics began a transition from amateur to professional, but it was an amateur hockey team made up of American college students that pulled off the biggest upset in the history of any sport. Television rights money for events increased exponentially. The word billions replaced millions in negotiations. This, in turn, sent sports salaries into the stratosphere through the 80s and the 90s. In at least one case, the NBA, one player more than earned his huge salary. Michael Jordan made the Pro Basketball League almost by himself. The NFL became a national obsession. Big League Baseball, despite strikes and endless haggling, maintained its place as the national game. And a women's soccer team grabbed the nation's attention. And now the century ends. The amateur world of 1900 has all but disappeared. The most flattering phrase that an athlete can hear is, he's a real pro. But the most dramatic change, the increase of minority participation. 77% of all NBA players. In the NFL, 65%. Baseball, 41%. And as the new millennium arrives, the most dramatic example is, of all things, a golfer. Until recent years, minorities were seated golf championships only as caddies. Now Tiger Woods, who celebrated his 24th birthday yesterday, is already spoken of with the same reverence as Jones, Hogan, Nelson, Snead, Nicholas, and Palmer. The century has seen dizzying changes on the planet with every passing year, but it took the entire 100 years for the sports scene to go from lily white to the rainbow landscape of skin color we see today. Let's hope we can pick up the pace in facing whatever new challenges arrive in the century to come.
Well, thank you very much for Jim McKay for doing that. Jim, I actually hadn't seen that before, though I'd read what you prepared. I'm a little troubled by the questionable exhibition sport roller derby. You shouldn't slam roller derby like that.
I shouldn't. Leo Seltzer's baby.
Yeah.
It was one of the big deals in the early days of television.
Is there ever a sport you didn't cover?
Any sport I haven't covered?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure there are somewhere. Actually, I haven't covered football for a long, long time. I did in the early days. I covered the Navy games when there were only seven stations, I believe, on the CBS network at that time. This was Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Washington. Only five stations. We were the fifth station in the country.
You know, given that we're talking about the century, the first great sports personality of the century is Babe Ruth.
Yes, to me, absolutely number one. Think about it, Peter. As a pitcher with the Boston Red Sox, every year, his earned run average was under 3. In 1 year, I believe it was under 2. Then he went to New York, was traded to New York, of course, and in the first year hit more home runs than the entire rest of the league. All the rest of the teams had hit. He was the first guy to hit 30 home runs, 40 home runs, 50 home runs, 60 home runs. And he and Judge Kennesaw Mountain Landis, I think, the first commissioner, actually saved the sport. In addition to that, he was the precursor of the big money days for professional athletes in this country. Remember, 1 year he made $100,000, I think, and somebody, this was during the Depression, and a reporter asked him, he said, you know, you made more money than President Hoover did last year. And the Babe said in his famous line, yeah, but I had a much better year than he did.
Exactly. You know, ESPN, I notice, has chosen Michael Jordan as the athlete of the century. I've seen other people wanted to choose Muhammad Ali, who we saw ring the opening bell today. Do you have one
I voted on that, and I voted for Babe Ruth number one and Muhammad Ali number two. I take nothing away from Michael Jordan. He is just unbelievable, and I'd walk a block to see him play anytime. But I think the other two just had such tremendous influence. They changed their sport and hit influences on society, too.
There was one other, thinking in global terms, I was reading Rob Hughes, who writes the sports column for the International Herald Tribune yesterday, and he chooses Pelé, the great soccer player.
Well, this was only supposed to be North Americans in the ESPN thing.
And, so, and where would you put someone like Pelé in terms of athlete of the century?
I would put him right up there. On world terms, I would put him up there with Muhammad Ali.
Now, in all of sports, you've ended up with your greatest love being horse racing, am I right?
Yeah, we didn't mention horse racing in the piece, and the reason is a lot of people, or some people anyway, don't consider jockeys or horses athletes, and I totally disagree with that. I mean, if Secretariat wasn't an athlete when he won the Belmont by 31 lengths, I don't know who was. And as for jockeys, you know, Dr. Curlin, who was the famous orthopedist out in California, once gave a number of athletes from all the sports tests in different disciplines. The winner, there were baseball players, football players, everybody. The winner was Bill Shoemaker, the famous jockey.
And of course, we just saw Willie Shoemaker's record broken just several weeks ago.
By Lafitte Pincai Jr. So you'd have to put in many famous athletes of the century, Shoemaker and the great Eddie Arcaro, Lafitte Pincai Jr., and probably some of the others of today.
Well, you've had a wonderful life, and you've brought us a wonderful world of sports for many years. It's great to see you. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you very much, Peter.
Jim McKay, who, when he's not calling him, is down at his farm in Baltimore and not too far from the track at any given moment. And just to bring back a few memories for him, I was talking a little bit about Ode to Joy. The first time I heard Ode to Joy that sticks absolutely in my memory is in Southern Africa, because many countries took Beethoven's Ninth Symphony and used it as their national anthem. Changed a great deal in Southern Africa. And of course, ABC chose it for many years to signify its coverage of the Olympics. So here, in honor of Jim McKay, is a little more Beethoven, Ode to Joy.
ESPN Classic presents a special New Year's Day showing of ESPN Sports Century's 50 Greatest Athletes. If you missed any of the 50 Greatest Athlete profiles, here's your chance to see the countdown presented in its entirety. An all-day, round-the-clock marathon that no sports fan should miss. Watch ESPN Sports Century's 50 Greatest Athletes Marathon beginning at 7 a.m. New Year's Day, only on ESPN Classic.
This is ABC 2000, the celebration of the millennium. Brought to you by Toyota, taking you into the new millennium. And by AccuView Contact Lenses, vision for the new millennium.
Introducing the new AccuView 2 contact lens. So natural, it feels like you're wearing nothing at all. For a free trial pair, call us or visit your eye care professional.
Announcing a new way to see, near and far. AccuView bifocal contact lens with pupil intelligent design. Call 1-800-531-2121 for a free trial pair or visit your eye care professional.
Take a look, not very subdued. Lots of other parties going on around India, down the beach in Goa, huge international party, palaces in Rajasthan. But right here, we have the folks out in the public square waiting to celebrate.
Peter?
Well, Lynn, this is now a nuclear nation as well, and as we said, about to become the world's most populous nation, perhaps sometimes in the next 50, the world's largest parliamentary democracy. There must be a tremendous sense of confidence there in many respects tonight.
You know, there is great hope and a lot of wishes here, but interestingly, wishes for ordinary things. A newspaper asked people what their wild wishes were. They said they want water to come out of the taps. They want people to be fed. A very sobering thought, even at an exciting moment like this.
Well, as we watch it, talk to us a little bit about whatever's going on there of your choice, but also about the two different kinds of India, urban and rural.
Well, let me first tell you that the people here tonight are celebrating mostly because they love a party. There's not a huge amount of excitement that it happens to be the turn of the millennium. India loves to celebrate. I'm told there are more holidays here than in any other country in the world. So this is just a great big party for them. But it is a land of immense contrast, Peter, as you well know. Here in Bombay, we have billionaires and we have rag pickers. This is a country where they've invented a huge amount of the world's computer software, and still more than half the country is illiterate. Just staggering, staggering poverty, and yet they do know how to have a good time.
Those
fireworks started now out on the...
And so India passes into the new millennium as well. This country that really had its greatest midnight only a couple of years ago when it celebrated its independence. 50 years ago, in 1948, the War of Independence, which led to partition between India and Pakistan and what is now Bangladesh.
And Peter, if I might add a very curious thing about the Hindi language, which is spoken by the majority of people here, although of course there are about 18 official languages, but in Hindi, the word yesterday is the same as the word for tomorrow. A very different sense of time from what we have in America.
What are we looking at in terms of a physical structure, Lynn?
You are looking at the Gateway of India, Peter. This is, curiously, a relic from the monarch. This was built at the beginning of this century, or now I should say the last one, 1911, to commemorate the visit by King George V, then the ruling monarch. Of course, India, as you say, now independent, the world's largest democracy, and it's just fine with them to be celebrating by a structure that was built to buy and to commemorate the British. That's okay. Nobody minds that the British were here as long as they've got their independence now.
And India got its independence from Britain, as we said, in 1947, and they've just had a very tough negotiation about a hijacking situation up in Afghanistan. Has that settled well with the people, the fact that India helped to resolve this as it did?
Peter, all the opinions are not in yet. I will tell you that while I was here, as you know, covering it during this week, and there was immense emotion about that issue. The people wanted, the Indians wanted their passengers back. They wanted their plane back. They are furious at the hijackers. There is a strong sense of continuing to fight for Kashmir. So I don't know how it's going to work since those three militants were released. This has yet to play out in the press and among the people. Right now, there is obviously exuberance that the crisis is over. But we don't have the fallout yet from the deal that was made by the Indian government with the hostage takers.
When we sent Lynn to India for this celebration, we also asked her to talk about population as well. Lynn, would you like to take us in that direction?
Peter, this is a country you've mentioned of 1 billion people. China already has 1 billion people. They got there in the 1980s. India just got there, at least by all estimates. But China has a literacy rate of around 80 or 83 or 90%, and in India, it's something like 53%. India has the same number of people. They have not done as well, and that's one of the huge problems here. Another major problem in India with the population is that something like a third of the population is under 25. Take a look at the situation in India and the rest of the developing world.
If every human on Earth weighed exactly the same, here's how our planet might look. Lopsided in Asia, specifically China and India, where one-third of the world's population now lives. It took the world three centuries until 1800 to grow to 1 billion. But it's taken India and China only three decades to get their populations to 1 billion each. By 2050, India is expected to add another 500 million, making it the most populous country on the globe. And that threatens already dwindling resources.
Many of these countries, including India, are simply outrunning their water supplies. Water shortages will translate into food shortages, and that in turn could increase malnutrition and hunger, and especially infant mortality.
More people also means more cities. Half the world is expected to live in urban areas within 5 years. And more pavement means less open land, less space for the other creatures on our planet. But India has actually started to slow its rate of growth, bringing fertility rates down.
In the middle of the 20th century, Indian women on average had about 6 children per woman. Today they have 3. That's both because Indian women, especially young Indian women, want smaller families than their mothers had, and it's also because the government has been at least modestly successful in providing good family planning services to the people of India.
Ironically, when family planning is too successful, falling birth rates can lead to equally gloomy predictions. In Italy, for instance, as in several other developed countries, more people are dying than are being born, which means the average age there by 2050 is predicted to be 70. The goal, experts say, to reach a stable society is for each couple to reproduce itself, 2 parents, 2 babies. That happens to be precisely where the United States is today. In other words, demography is not destiny. Societies can change. The question is, can those facing the biggest challenges change fast enough to make a difference?
Where is that? And so we get a look at the burdens of population and the challenges of population in the next century. I want to go back to Lynn Sher very briefly in India. Lynn, that celebration that we've been watching behind you, I apologize for still being confused, is out in the harbor, out in the bay of Bombay? No, not this one,
yes,
the one
Peter,
that we've been watching on videotape.
That is right behind me in the Arabian Sea. It's in the harbor, right behind the gateway of India. To get your bearings, I know you've been here lots. The Taj Mahal Hotel, which supplied the fireworks, is essentially where I'm standing. Right behind me is the large public space.
Right.
The gateway is behind my right shoulder, the Arabian Sea behind my left. That's what's going on back
there.
Okay,
thanks very much. Apologize for my confusion. Lynn Sher, by the way, is going to chat live from Bombay on abcnews.com. Lynn, this is your first visit to India. I want to know what your most powerful impression is.
The answer is the number of people. It's staggering. It's so hard to wrap your mind around the fact that there are this many people almost everywhere, Peter. This country adds 20 million people a year. That's the size of Australia. 50,000 new babies a day. You see it in the cities. You see it in the countryside. This is a very, very large train to start to turn around. It's happening, but it's going to take a while. Peter?
Okay, Lynn, thanks very much for a wonderful job in India. What a place to celebrate the new millennium, looking at the past and the future. In terms of population, I want to talk just a little bit with someone who's a student of population, and we're now talking about population growth in very dramatic ways. Ken Dykwald in San Francisco, who's the author of How the 21st Century Will Be Ruled by the New Old. You're a baby boomer, I can tell by looking at you. As you see us going around the world today, Ken, and looking at the exploding population in some places, it must give you shivers in some respects.
Well, yes, it does. Just to imagine the idea of 20 million births per year in India, which is 5 times the number of births than there were during our great baby boom after World War II. But as you know, what I find particularly interesting is not just the number of babies being born, but how many of us will be living longer and longer and even longer in the 21st century.
So as a demographer in some respects, what do you think it's going to look like by 2050?
Well, Peter, with regard to longevity, let's keep in mind that throughout 99% of human history, the average life expectation worldwide was less than 18 years. The truth of it is, in the past, most people didn't age. We all died very young. In the 19th and 20th centuries, we've seen extraordinary advances in medicine and pharmacy and public health, which have begun to give us all somewhat of a taste of a long life. But the real longevity revolution, the real fireworks, are just about to occur. I think there's a very strong likelihood that by the middle of this new century, average life expectancy in the industrialized worlds will have lifted up to somewhere between 90 and 100. And I think people living to 120 or 150 will become commonplace.
Which raises all sorts of potential burdens. The United Nations tells us we'll spend more time caring for our parents and for our children in this century.
Right, and the parents that will be cared for at the end of the day will be us. One of the hardest things for people in our age group to consider is that when we think of the new old, those people living 80 or 100 or 150 years in this new century, this will not be our mom and dad's generation necessarily. This will be ours. We will be the people living these long lives, going back to school at 70, late blooming at 90, learning new technologies and new careers at 100. And I was even reflecting, Peter, that if you and I are still around, we might be doing this show 100 years from now, with a little more gray in our hairs.
Well, you might be doing it around. And I notice you're the one who calls it from baby boom to age wave, right? Is that your? Did you coin that phrase?
Yes, that is a phrase I've used, yes.
And have you any predictions about the century? It won't do you any bodily harm if you can't think of one on the spot.
No, the truth of it is the 20th century was very much the century of youth, and that youth really hit its high point with the emergence of the 78 million strong baby boom in the second half of this century. But in the 21st century, the population growth we're going to see here is going to be from people over the age of 50. The new Mick Jagger at 56, you know, the Sean Connery at 69, the John Glenn going up into space at 78. And so the boomers will not give up their center of gravity. They won't give up their power, but they will adopt a new mantle, a new style, and the style will be maturity. And in truth, in the years to come, the mature population will control more and more of the economic strength, they'll have unrivaled political might, and indeed the epicenter of American culture and all the modernized nations of the world will shift from youth to old. And as you said at the beginning of this segment, whereas the 20th century was ruled by the young, the 21st century is going to be ruled by the new old.
Ken, thank you very much. Ken Dykewall in San Francisco. Very interesting take on what it's going to be like in the next century. As I said, ABC's Lynn Chur can be talked to in person from Bombay on abcnews.com. We'll be back in just a moment.
From around the world, ABC 2000. We'll continue in a moment.
Hey, Jeff. Now listen, I got it right here, buddy. It's icy cold and tasting great. Now come on, Jeff, you tell me. Is there anybody in this world who deserves this here Pepsi more than you?
Hi, Jeff.
See you later, Jeff.
Now that's what I call motivation.
I don't know where she came from. The
joy of cola. Don't worry, Jeff. There's always Daytona.
You are in the fight of your life. Just you against your smoking addiction, one-on-one. Trouble is, it's not a fair fight, and few people win it. But you can give yourself a fighting chance to win with Zyban. Zyban doesn't work for everyone. Zyban is part of a comprehensive program from your doctor to help you stop smoking. It's different from nicotine replacements. Zyban is the only prescription medicine that's nicotine-free, so you don't have to stop smoking all at once. As Zyban reduces your cravings, you feel like smoking less and less until you're ready to stop completely because you're ready to win. You should know there is a risk of seizure associated with Zyban. To reduce the risk, don't take Zyban if you have or have had a seizure or eating disorder, or if you take Wellbutrin. Don't take Zyban if you use an MAO inhibitor. Side effects may include dry mouth and difficulty sleeping. Ask your doctor if Zyban is right for you because it can help you quit smoking by making it a fight you can win. Zyban, you don't have to quit all at once.
Cellular One.
Oblivious to what goes on around us, you've noticed several fire trucks in the middle of the square at the moment, which is why these lanes are left over. There's something going on, and it's in our building. right above us. You can see just above us there. We don't think it's serious, but now you get a very good, clear example of why the New York authorities leave all of the side streets open, though you can't park a car within 24 square blocks of this place, and how easy and how efficiently they have made it for the fire department to get around this particular part of town today. There's something going on above us. We do not know what it is, but we do not believe it is serious. Now, we've had the most serious and wonderful exhibition of century change in many parts of the world. And before the end of the day is, I hope if you haven't seen them all, we'll make sure that you do see them all. Let's go to Asia again, where so many of the great dramatic moments have occurred so far in terms of celebration. First, to the capital of China, used to be called Peking, now it's Beijing. The Communist Chinese leadership showed up in the land which gave the rest of the world fireworks, where many of the fireworks in the world are still preserved to celebrate as they did on the banks of the river which separates the Bund in Old Shanghai to New Shanghai. That's New Shanghai. And this is Taiwan. There's a plethora of fireworks. But here in Taiwan, they've did something interesting, flying the sky lanterns. For centuries, they were used as the way to communicate. And then we went to Indonesia as well, that troubled nation today, to celebrate on the island of Java and see the celebration there of the long 4,000-year history of Indonesia as well. That was the quickest highlight package I've seen in a long time, Roger. At any rate, there are these wonderful crowds in Times Square which have given this place absolutely tremendous sense of block-to-block-to-block enthusiasm, because as the rest of the world has celebrated, the Times 2000 group here has celebrated right along with them. And as we count down in various parts of the world, we have had the people in Times Square counting down with us as well. We don't know if they fixed the clock in Paris, but we certainly know that Charlie Gibson is in London. Charlie?
Peter, as I have watched you now for almost 9 hours, you know, I think broadcasters get somewhat jaded about what we can do in terms of linking parts of the world, but this is really the most extraordinary example I've ever seen of putting together literally the global village as you've gone from the remote islands in the South Pacific through Japan, China, India, just a few moments ago. These linkages are so important, and the expressions of hope that we have seen from every country so important. I mention all of this because there was a very important linkage just a few moments ago, actually put together by the BBC and RTE, which is the Irish broadcasting system. In the center of Derry, Londonderry, the embattled town of Northern Ireland, there were 100,000 people gathered, 2,000 singers, linked symbolically and literally with Dublin, where the three Irish tenors and a female soloist as well were singing in front of a crowd of 20,000, and they sang the haunting Irish melody, Danny Boy. Together, and it is such a sign of hopefulness in Ireland, where maybe, maybe, maybe there is now a chance for peace. given the efforts of so many in the North, in the South, Senator Mitchell from the United States, among others, maybe there's a chance for peace. And that linkage, very symbolic of it. Singers in Derry and singers in Dublin united in song, Peter.
Thanks, Charlie. The Derry air, from the siege of Derry in 1689 to now, to the end of the Troubles. Long, long time. And very moving. Some people I know could listen to that song all day and probably all night. We'll be back in a minute, but as we go out, let's check the first sunrise in Sydney, Australia. Isn't it appropriate? The man playing the didgeridoo is of Irish heritage.
Century. The first attempt to defy death took some rehearsal, but when midnight struck, the chord was ready, the jumper was ready, and so were the record books. And while much of the world celebrated in traditional costumes with customs that go back centuries, Philadelphia began its day's celebrations in sweats, running up the steps of the Art Museum, a tradition that dates back to the first Rocky movie, back in the late 70s. And while none of these events may be as spectacular as this one, don't try telling that to them or to her.
There will be so many more firsts by the time we're finished. Thank you very much, Aaron Brown. As we were talking to Jim McKay, we couldn't help but be struck by how much change there has been in the area of sports, particularly for women. And in Insight magazine recently, there's an article which says, by the middle of the 21st century, female athletes not only will compete head-to-head against males, but in fact may overtake them, particularly in track and swimming. To talk about women in sports, we're joined from our bureau, I believe, in Los Angeles, ABC and ESPN's Robin Roberts. Robin, what's your first thought about women in this century and sports?
My first thought is I go to 1932 and Babe Diedrichson Zaharias was so bold, so brash, was such a fabulous athlete in track and field, later was one of the founders of the LPGA Tour and won many golf tournaments. But really, you know, this is a time when everyone's looking back and trying to find the significant occurrences of the century, and Babe Diedrichson was the first bona fide superstar for women athletes in this century. And you follow that up in 1972, which was a very significant time for all women, and the fact that Title IX was passed. I am a baby of Title IX. I was 12 years old, and Peter, I can remember the distinct difference before Title IX and after. Before,
you better explain to people what Title IX is.
Title IX was the passage in which that if a sport was made available for a man, it had to also be made available for a woman, especially in schools. Any school that received federal funding had to also make sure that a sport was available for both girls and boys. And the fact that that happened in 1972 at a time when a lot of things were happening for women in this country, equal rights and such, I really feel it was one of the most significant occurrences of the 20th century for women in this country.
Did it make a difference in terms of prowess, or I shouldn't say simply, but simply inequality? Did it make difference in more than just political and social equality?
It was, it's far-reaching. When I say that I am a product of Title IX, it has nothing to do with the fact that I went on to be a network sportscaster. It has everything to do with the fact that I was given an opportunity, exposed to the same things that men were exposed to in sport. The intangibles that you learn about being self-confident, all those things that for generations, centuries if you will, men have used to go on to be successful in businesses and other areas of life. It has nothing to do simply with the playing field. And that was the impact of Title IX, the fact that it was able to make women exposed to something to help them be more powerful outside of the playing field.
For no particular reason, two things come to mind. I mean, first of all, how popular girls' basketball is in parts of the country, and secondly, what John McEnroe has been saying recently about men's tennis and women's tennis. Women's tennis is, quite frankly, just more interesting than men's tennis to a great many people at the moment. Do you foresee a time when men and women are going to compete in some sports on an equal footing?
Well, I go back again to 1972 when Billie Jean King competed against Bobby Riggs. And
that was a gimmick.
But perhaps it was more symbolic than it was significant. And you're correct there about being a gimmick. But it was a gimmick. I can still hear our former colleague Howard Cosell calling the action in the Astrodome. It was full. It was a capacity crowd. Millions upon millions watching on television. Until recently, it was the most watched sporting event of the century. That kind of impact, the fact that they were playing a man playing against a woman, and Billie Jean King really didn't want to play that match, but Margaret Court had lost to Bobby Riggs earlier, so it really forced her to play. But to answer your question, do I think there will be a time that men and women will compete head-to-head? No. I mean, genetically, men are more powerful. That's not something that's going to change. Perhaps it will in the 21st century, but it's more important that women be given an opportunity in the WNBA to play, not necessarily in the NBA. If someone should be successful and be able to play in the NBA, well, so be it. But I think it's more important that they have a venue in which they can play on equal footing.
Okay, well, thanks very much, Robin Roberts. We watch you often on sports. Thank you very much for talking to us about women in sports today. There's another line in that same article which says that one of the things we should look forward to in the 21st century is that the possibility that a female athlete will break the gender barrier. It's one of the things to look forward to as we look ahead. We'll be back.
ABC 2000 will continue live from around the world in just a moment.
Let us give you some headlines in the rest of the world. It was a tremendous day here on Wall Street. The place you may have been with us ended with a tremendous bang, full of bells, whistles, and a couple of records. The Dow Jones Industrials went up 44 points to close at 11,497. That gives the index a 25% gain for the year. And the NASDAQ climbed just over 32 points to 4,069. That's up 84% from last year on the NASDAQ. A little while ago, well, we'll come to the Panama Canal and Cuba in just a second, but the big news earlier this morning was that President Boris Yeltsin of Russia said he was out of it. He was no longer going to be the president. He turned over power to Vladimir Putin, who's become Russia's acting president. And Mr. Putin and Mr. Yeltsin and President Clinton have all been in touch with one another. And not too long ago, there was the official ceremony which made Panama the sole owner, the sole guardian, the sole controller of the Panama Canal, taking us back very much in memory terms to the beginning of the century when the United States built the Panama Canal, which made us think that in 1900, Havana, in fact, all of Cuba, was under U.S. military control after Spain's defeat in the Spanish-American War of 1898. And then in 1959, Fidel Castro came to power, and the United States and Cuba have had this utterly strange, in many people's views, and very cantankerous, very antagonistic relationship ever since. And this afternoon, where old Havana meets the new city, we are going to go to Cynthia McFadden, who is there in the heart of the old city. Hi, Cynthia, and what's it like in Cuba today?
Hello, Peter. I'm standing in Central Park in Havana. Today is a national holiday, and while it is officially the year 2000 about to happen here, the millennium doesn't officially begin until next year. So if you miss the celebrations this year, you can come down next year because there will be celebrations once again. We paid a visit yesterday to the schools to talk to children about the start of the year 2000 and their feelings about the United States. It was a fascinating day. Part of what the children talked about was their fear of the United States and how they felt that they didn't want to come to the United States because it was a place where they kidnapped children, a direct reference, of course, to Elian Gonzalez. The children also said that the United States was just a place where there was money and money wasn't what was most important. I should mention, Peter, that, you know, as you talk about the global community, Cuba is a place because of the small number of computers here. In the classrooms we visited yesterday, there was certainly no computers and almost no paper that we could see. This is a place where the children's role models, their idols are not the baseball players or Madonna or pop stars. Their role models are engineers and teachers and librarians, which is who all the children we spoke to yesterday said they wanted to be.
Well, from a Cuban point of view, as everybody knows, I guess education and participation in the third world are very much what Cuba has stood for, at least in the developing world. I know you have a very important guest there with you, so why don't you introduce him and perhaps talk with him before he leaves on us.
Yes, exactly. Peter, well, as you know, Ricardo Alarcón is the president of the National Assembly, and he joins me here in Central Park. Mr. Alarcón, welcome. And let me ask you, what is the change in power in the Soviet Union today? What does that mean for Cuba?
Well, I think that it's an internal matter of Russia, and I hope that the country will continue evolving normally, and that President Yeltsin's substitute will continue conducting the country in a proper way.
As you reflect back on the years since the revolution here, what do you see as the greatest accomplishment of the revolution?
The greatest accomplishment is the sense of dignity and independence that our people now enjoys.
And what would you say is something that you hope to see achieved for Cuba in the years to come?
I think that our people, as everybody else, look forward to a new era of peace, of tranquility, of prosperity. And I would say, talking to you at this moment, that we would especially look forward to having a normal and friendly relationship with the American people, as good neighbors should do.
Do you anticipate the end of the embargo?
I am sure that, of course, not in the new millennium or even in the new century, but pretty soon that policy has to be changed. We are now entering a new year, a turning point in history. Cubans are celebrating, as everybody throughout the world, but as you know, Cynthia, at the same time, it's a sad moment for us because one child and one family has been arbitrarily separated from each other. And that's a very sorrow element in our celebration this day.
Well, Peter, one of the things you had said to me before coming to Cuba was to look at the billboards for what the Cuban people were thinking. The billboards here in Havana and throughout the countryside have Ilian Gonzalez, the six-year-old young boy who is in Miami, have his picture plastered across them saying, "Free Elian." Sources have told us from Washington and from high-level sources here in Cuba that the INS is going to be interviewing Elian's father once again in the days to come. Can you comment on that?
I would not like to make any comment that may create difficulties to the process that the INS is doing. Let me just say that INS met with this father almost 18 days ago, that they had received more than a month ago a formal request from a father to have his son back. And I am sure that the father will be ready to do any additional effort to fulfill that dream. The problem is that INS should really act. A boy belongs with his father, and it's particular this time of the year. It is very, very sad to see that this small child has been separated.
Mr. Alarcón, it's Peter Jennings. It's Peter Jennings in New York.
Hello, how are you?
How are you, sir? Nice to see you again. I have one question about the continuing saga of Ilian Gonzalez. Are you surprised to see how the already difficult relationship between the United States and Cuba can get set off almost explosively by a single incident like this? It doesn't argue very well for the two countries getting closer together in the next century, does it?
What happens?
Does it? I think that
is a very simple problem that should have not existed at all. It's not a matter for governments, not a matter for politics. It's a very simple matter. A child belongs with his father. That's something that is clear in your law, is clear in your tradition. Is at this time of the year, we should be paying tribute to family, to respect this institution that is so fundamental in your culture as it is in ours.
Well, Mr. Alarcón, forgive me for interrupting, and I apologize for interrupting. But I guess the point I was making that in your country and in this one, the incident of Gonzalez, Ilian Gonzalez, has become an enormous political event. You've made an enormous political event in Cuba. I take your point about what you say, a child and his father. I think many Americans do, but it's become an enormous political event in both countries. How do the two countries get closer together? How do the problem of Cuban-American relations ever get solved if this can be something like this can be so explosive?
Well, what about returning a small boy to his father as a first step? It is true that here in this country that has become a very big issue. But we started complaining more than a week after Elian was in the hand of a bunch of local politicians in Miami that tried to manipulate that small boy for political purposes. That's something completely un-American and un-Cuban. Let's have the child back with his father, with his four grandparents and his great-grandmother. All of them are here. All of them are waiting for him. Let's get out the politics of this issue, but only with the only possible solution, returning him where he belongs.
Thank you very much for your time. Ricardo Alarcón, the president of Cuba's National Assembly, one of the most influential politicians in Cuba, but he certainly makes the point that we're all aware of. By the way, we're going to go back to Cynthia as the day goes on, because there will be an important and very festive celebration in Cuba tonight, which will evoke a lot of memories for Americans. But Mr. Alarcón makes a very good point that the boy has become a very powerful tool, or become a pawn, really, in a very powerful argument which continues to go on between Fidel Castro and the Cuban exile community, or at least much of it, in the United States. We'll continue our celebrating in Warsaw, the Polish capital.
This regional rap is a rebel through the streets of Poland, Ireland. Is there no other such thing as rent on this night of heading for the millennium? Let's have some fun before it's all done. Join us, don't forget on the Polish bus. Listen to Mami show Apache.
You get a hint in the background there of a city that's seen so much history. Rap in Warsaw, the city destroyed by the Germans during World War II and later restored, at least here at the center. This performance is hope. Of all the countries in Eastern Europe, Poland has probably done as well as any, in many cases better, since the end of communism. It all began with solidarity. There you see the old castle in the background. Not much left after World War II. Polish state itself is 1,000 years old, and when we come back, we're going to talk to Cokie Roberts in Rome about the Polish Pope, John Paul II.
This is ABC 2000, the celebration of the millennium. Brought to you by Britannica.com, what's on your mind? And by Hewlett-Packard, a company of inventors in Silicon Valley.
The most remarkable garage in the world. The garage that invented an industry, that reinvented work with a few simple rules. Work quickly, no bureaucracy, just invent. For six decades, this garage has been the workshop of the world's inventors. It will be still, because the company that began in this garage will return to the rules of this garage. Watch.
It's a freedom.
A Swedish star here, there, and everywhere, Robin. The King and Queen of Sweden who decided to give this party in the Royal Palace, a 300-year-old Royal Palace right in the center of Stockholm. Sits even on a couple of other castles that were there before it. Robin. in Sweden so far, they have been more dressed up than anybody else we have seen so far in the world. I think that is Victoria, the Crown Princess of Sweden, the heir to the throne there, home on vacation from her studies at Yale University in the United States. So many people in this new century still coming, still increasingly coming to America from around the world, particularly for their advanced education. One word about that fire that was upstairs in our building. It's not a fire. They apparently vent the steam out of this building every day, but nobody bothered to tell the fire department, or somebody called the fire department when they didn't really need to do it. We said we were going to talk a little bit about the Polish Pope, so let's go to Vatican City and to ABC's Koki Roberts. Koki, what has the Pope's day been like today? He is, after all, so old and so frail.
Well, he actually was looking pretty good earlier today, Peter, looking ruddy and healthy. He's just had an absolutely beautiful Vespers service here at St. Peter's, where he gave a message about mankind being the only creature that understands about the passing of time, and warned, said we can write our own histories, and warned about writing a history for the next century where science should, technology should work to benefit humans, not to hurt them. Pope will come out again at midnight at the traditional spot at his window to give another message. But before that, there will be rock music here in St. Peter's Square, something called Hot Music, an Italian heartthrob, Claudio Baglioni, and Queen Esther Marrow from Harlem will be here, which means you gotta love Italy, Peter. This is a country where you can do anything like that. And I think a year without Italy is a very bad year indeed. And I want to show you something we've put together from A to Z. It's the best country on earth. Angelo, Arno, the river, Antipasto, Armani, Giorgio Armani, Alps, artichokes, and then there's Botticelli, Bellini, Bernini, Bacci. Bacci. And Bacci. It's hard to argue with Cafe Espresso, Cappuccino, Cupids, Crucifixes, Cardinals. Or take David, Dante, Donatello, Della Robbia, Del Sarto, Da Vinci, Dolce. Delicious. Etna. Ekberg in La Dolce Vita. F is fantastico. We have Focaccio, Formaggio, Fagioli, Fettuccini, Fellini, Florence, frescoes, fountains. What about Ghirlandaio, gondolas, Giotto, Giardino, Gucci, Hadrian's Villa, Hotel Hassler, or simply Italia? Indubitably, indisputably, incredible. Not convinced? How about Julius Caesar? The Coffee House di Boboli,